UX and ID design. When we think about color, we are really needing to discuss a little bit about light. And because color is a product of light, of course, being in the electromagnetic spectrum, it's produced in a range of intensities or wavelengths, I guess it would be a better term for it, wavelengths that make up visible light, which is what we see. And if we think of these different wavelengths, the wavelengths of the light rays as they come across maybe from the sun, we can tell that there is color based on the wavelength. So when you see a rainbow with the classic colors, Roy G. Biv, the red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet, what we're seeing is we're seeing various wavelengths of light, and that's what make us see different colors. When we talk about the light that's being generated from the sun, we need to differentiate between additive color and subtractive color. Additive color would be light that's generated by something that produces light, like the sun, or a light bulb, or a computer monitor, or something like that, a television, a smartphone, all of those things generate light, versus subtractive color, which are things that reflect light. So like a painting, a picture, a magazine, a newspaper, all of those different things are the reflection of light. And so light wavelengths are subtracted, they're absorbed by those things, and then others are reflected, and that's what we see. Where additive color, it is based on specifically the wavelengths of light that we see, and as we add more wavelengths, we get different colors. So we need to consider our management of color. And when we consider color management, we are really most concerned in our instance with the color space that we would be using, which just about every device now in today's world, whether it be a computer, a smartphone, or so forth, uses the sRGB color space. And a color space includes a gamma correction curve, which would be based on the luminance of the colors involved or the light involved, and also a gamut of colors. And a gamut of colors are all of the colors that can be produced by that color space. So we can't produce every single color that could possibly be seen by anybody anywhere in the world. We have to limit ourselves to the most important colors, and that would be the gamut of colors. So in the sRGB color space, we have a specific gamut of colors that are available to us. Now, I wanted to talk about this in terms of Photoshop. If we go over here to Photoshop, if I open up our color tile, we can see that we have different colors available to us. Let's say that I choose a color up here. Let's go up into the blues, and I choose a color. Right now, I have this set for sRGB, so all of these colors that are within this gamut are going to be in the sRGB color space. So all of these will be within the gamut, if you want to look at it that way. But I want to direct your attention to this right here that says, click to select web safe color. This can be confusing to a lot of people. I hope it's not confusing to any of us. But a web safe color, it's really an archaic term. If we click on that, it's going to give us a value. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about hexadecimal, but you can see this is all going to be numbers in hexadecimal that are divisible by 3. 0, 3, 9, C, and F are all divisible by 3. So all of these numbers here in the hex are going to be divisible by 3 if it's a web safe color. But this is really archaic. We don't need to worry about web safe colors because just about every computer and web browser on Earth is going to be using the sRGB color space as opposed to an older system that used what was required with these web safe colors. So if we come back over here, we're not as concerned about web safe. All right, so as far as choosing colors, I want to show a color wheel here. This is a color wheel from color.adobe.com, which is where I like to choose my colors. This is the color wheel. It represents all the wavelengths of light that are available to us within the sRGB color space. And we can see right now it's on a circle, 360 degrees. And as we have one point on one end, on the opposite end is going to be 180 degrees different, if you want to look at it that way, as far as a circle is concerned. The primary colors of the additive sRGB color space, sRGB, we've got red, green, blue. So right here I've got reds over here, I've got green over here, I've got blue over here. These are the primary colors in the sRGB color space, or in an additive color space. And from these primary colors, red, green, and blue, we can make any other color that we need to. We can just change the values or intensities of those red, green, and blue colors. The secondary colors are going to be a mixture. So if I mix red and green, I'm going to end up with yellow. If I mix green and blue, I'm going to end up with cyan. If I mix blue and red, I'm going to end up with magenta. So it's interesting that yellow, cyan, and magenta, of course, are the primary colors for a subtractive color space, which would be things that reflect light. Tertiary colors are going to be colors in between the primary colors and the secondary colors, so we end up with an orange, or a lighter green, or a more cyan-looking green, and so forth. Those are our tertiary colors. Now, as far as choosing colors themselves, there's a few different ways we can do this. One way is to choose analogous colors, which I have, or analogous colors. I have that selected here. So as I spin and choose a specific color on my color wheel, then the system is going to choose for me colors that are nearby. These are analogous colors to the ones that I've chosen. I can spread these out quite a ways, but the closer I get to them, the more analogous they are. I can change this to monochromatic, and in monochromatic you can see I've got one hue of a color, one specific wavelength, and I've got different tints or shades of that are available to me, and all of those are selected down here. If I drop this down and select triad, I'm going to end up with not only 180 degrees out of phase, but just a little bit outside of what is 360 divided by 3 is going to be 120. So these would be 120 degrees out of phase. So as I spin one of these around, I'm going to end up with a triad of colors that all look good. As we look at these different colors down here, we can see they all look pretty tasty as far as I'm concerned. Drop this down, we've got complementary. These are going to be colors that are 180 degrees out of phase. As I spin this around, you can see that I end up with all of these different shades, different tints that are within that 180 degrees out of phase. And of course, these all look good together. Drop it down one more time. Now, this is my favorite. This is one that gives quite a different array of colors that can be used. This is our compound colors. And these, you can see there's a few that are complementary, some that are analogous, and so forth. And these all look good together. Last one we'll look at are different shades. This again is going to be monochromatic, but you're going to have different shades, darker, right? So shade is taking the color and adding black to it. So that's what all of this is. So as we come back here, we've got all the list here. So we've split complementary is one that we did not talk about. With split complementary, that's more of that triad looking color. Shades would be any hue of color that adds black to make it darker, and a tint is going to be a hue of color that adds white to make it a little bit lighter. Last thing I want to talk about is the hexadecimal system. In sRGB color space, we've got 8-bit color, which means that there are 8 bits of computer information per channel. There's 3 channels, one for red, one for green, one for blue, which means we've got 24 bits total of computer information, if you want to think about it that way, available to us to represent a color. 2 to the 24th power, which is based on this 24 bits, gives us the ability to have 16,777,216 different possible colors in the sRGB color space. And what this means is that we've got 2 to the 8th power, or 256 different colors per channel. So 256 values of red, 256 values of green, and 256 values of blue. We add those all up, we change them around, that gives us that just under 17 million different possibilities. These are numbered 0 through 255 in the decimal system. It's going to be 0, meaning none of that channel, red, green, blue. 255 meaning the most of that color, the greatest amount. But this 0 through 255 is actually kind of difficult. Hexadecimal simplifies this, even though it may not seem so at first. Hexadecimal literally means base 16, 1/6 hexadecimals, decimal is 10, hexa is 6, hexadecimal then becomes base 16, which means there are 16 numbers in this, or 16 characters in this numbering system, and they are the numbers 0 through 9 and the numbers A through F. Keep in mind that these are representing numbers, so there is no number 10 that's represented by a character A. So when you see the character A in hexadecimal, that's a representation of the decimal number 10. And the character F is a representation of the decimal character 15. So the highest value per channel that's possible is the characters FF, which would be equal to 255 in decimal. The highest value for all three channels, if we were to have all three channels, it's going to be a pair of characters or numbers for each of the channels. FF, FF, FF is going to be a representation of the number 16,777,215 in decimal, which would equal white. You can see that that's one less than the total number available, and that's because we've got 0, which would be a representation of black. So I want to demonstrate this for you. If we go back to Photoshop, And I open this up, you can see that I've got this, I don't know, a lot of people call this hashtag or a number sign or a pound sign, whatever you want to call it. I've heard it lots of different things, but this is representing the hexadecimal. You can see if I have six zeros in here, that's two for the red, two for the green, two for the blue. That's a representation of black. If I type in six Fs, you can see now that I've got white. And if I have FF0000, that's going to be red because the first two characters are going to be red. If I do the second pair of characters, that's green. Third pair of characters, that's blue. So we've got full red. This is going to be full red. I can also mix these colors. So if I mix red and green, that's going to be, of course, yellow, which we saw on the color wheel. And I can generate any color. If I want to have a shade of gray, then all three of these numbers, these are really just three numbers, would all need to be the same. So if I go 0C, 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 those are all the same number, 0C, 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 that's three numbers. That would just be like putting, say, 10, 10, 10, right? That's three numbers that are all the same. This is 0C, 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 or I could do 9A, 9A, 9A. These are all going to be shades of gray. All of these numbers are the exact same. Of course, I would need to put it in right, I guess. 9A, 9A, 9A. There we go with a shade of gray. So hexadecimal is very, very good for us. In fact, if I come over here to the color wheel and I decide I want to choose a color, I've got RGB. These are all going to be numbers in between 0 and 255. And the hex values, I can just double click on this, copy it. And if I come over here into Photoshop, I can paste it. And very, very quickly have that exact color that I had there. That's a lot easier than typing in the red, green, and blue values in decimal, which I'd have to copy and paste three times. I just copy and paste one value here. So hexadecimal is really valuable for us. All right, that's all I have for this. I hope that was beneficial for you as far as color theory is concerned. I know I went quickly. If you have any questions, do let me know.